I didn't know that either. You'll see that one. Let's check this. Good morning, everyone. So, in the last class, we've talked about some jaundice and on the liver and anatomy of the liver. In this class, I'll be talking about ascites and alcoholic liver disease. So just review about what was taught last class and just discuss a case. On routine physical examination, in 25-year-old man is found to have lab values as total bilirubin is 50, it's raised. Unconjugated bilirubin is normal, 0.8. SGOT, SGPT is normal. And alkaline phosphatase is also normal. Liver biopsy was performed and the tissue obtained is black in appearance. Which of the following disorders is the cause of the above condition? So this this is a case of isolated hyperbilirubinemia. So only the bilirubin is raised, all the enzymes are normal. So I've discussed in the last class, these are the some of the congenital hyperbilirubin conditions. So you all know, so unconjugated hyperbilirubin is seen in Crigler-Najjar type 1, type 2. And also Gilbert syndrome. These two are conditions where you see isolated unconjugated hyperbilirubins. But here unconjugated bilirubin is normal. So it is conjugated hyperbilirubin. So it comes to only these two conditions, Rotor's and Dubin-Johnson. So these two are the only conditions left out. So black pigment is usually seen in Dubin-Johnson because there is coarse pigment here in the centrilobular hepatocytes. You see this histology, liver histology shows coarse pigment in centrilobular hepatocytes, which is seen in only Dubin-Johnson. Rotor syndrome, it's not seen, it's completely normal. But these, just remember, this table is very important. Dubin-Johnson and Rotor syndrome are conjugated hyperbilirubins, whereas these three, type 1, CN and Gilbert's are unconjugated hyperbilirubins. Okay. Okay, coming back to the ascites, today's topic. So telling you the anatomy of the portal circle, I've already told liver around 70 to 80% circulation is from the portal vein. Okay, so this is the portal vein, and blood from the systemic circulation reaches the liver through portal vein, and from there it reaches the liver, and then these are the hepatic sinusoids. So then from the hepatic sinusoids, it reaches the hepatic veins. It has left, right and middle hepatic veins. From the hepatic veins, it reaches inferior vena cava. Inferior vena cava, it goes to the, lungs, get oxygenated again, come back as from the hepatic veins into the liver. So this is the circulation. So this circulation, this portal circulation is very important. This portal vein against it gets divided into splenic vein, supplies to the splenic, then inferior mesenteric vein to the left colon, superior mesenteric vein into the right colon and small intestine. Okay. Okay. So ascites. What is the definition of ascites? Ascites is defined as accumulation of free fluid in the peritoneal cavity. Okay. So clinical features, usually the patient has increase in the abdominal girth. Usually ascites, you note that increase in the abdominal girths only in the flanks, it's not in the center, usually in the flanks. So that's why you see shifting dullness positive, and fluid thrill, if the fluid is around 1500 ml, you see fluid thrill positive. Shifting dullness, even if the fluid is around 500 ml, you can see if shifting dullness is positive. And USG can detect up to 300, just 300 ml also it can detect. So whenever a patient with ascites comes, whenever you see an increase in abdominal girth, what you have to do is, first thing you should do is diagnostic paracentesis. So ascitic tap, should do ascitic tap and calculate sag. What is sag? So sag is difference between serum albumin, the serum albumin minus the ascitic albumin. So we'll have to do a sag ratio. This will tell if the cause is either portal hypertension or non-portal hypertension. Okay, so that's why sag is very important. So that's nothing but serum albumin minus ascitic albumin. Okay, so how do you do ascitic fluid analysis? So you, this is how you differentiate each cause. So if it is cirrhosis, usually the ascitic fluid is clear, straw colored or light green. If it is malignant disease, usually it is bloody, hemorrhagic. Okay, infection, it's usually cloudy. And if there is any biliary communication, heavy bile staining, and lymphatic obstruction, it is usually milky white. So always remember, cirrhosis, it is clear straw colored. Okay, if it is bloody, it's usually malignant. And then you'll have to do some other investigations like total albumin. This is for calculating SAG ratio. So you'll have to do total serum albumin as well as cytic albumin, and then amylase and neutrophil count. So usually this condition called SPP, spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. If the absolute neutrophil count in the cytic fluid is greater than 250, usually label it as SPP. Then you also send for cytology and then microscopic culture. So all these you're supposed to do. These are part of paracentesis, cytic fluid analysis. Okay. So this is how you classify based on SAG ratio. If the SAG ratio is greater than, that is serum albumin minus cytic albumin, is greater than 1.1, usually all these, you say it, the cause is due to portal hypertension. If it is less than 1.1, it is not due to portal hypertension, it's some other causes. Okay, so again, so let's come to this. If it is less than 1.1, the cause could be either nephrotic syndrome, it could be pancreatitis, tuberculosis. This is the most common cause with SAG less than 1.1. So tuberculosis, peritoneal carcinomatosis. These are the causes with SAG less than 1.1. In greater than 1.1, it's again you divide based on ascitic protein. Okay, so you calculate ascitic protein. If it is less than 2.5, so this is transudate. Okay, so usually cirrhosis is the most common cause. Late Bacchiari syndrome and massive liver metastasis. Okay, and if the ascitic protein is greater than 2.5, it is due to heart failure or constrictive pericarditis, early Bacchiari syndrome, IVC obstruction, and sinusoidal obstruction syndrome. This table is very important. They may ask usually some MCQs like the SAG of the, they'll give you the serum albumin, they'll give you the ascitic albumin, and they'll tell what could be the cause. So they'll give something like cirrhosis, pancreatitis, tuberculosis, so liver metastasis. So this is why SAG is very important. So you just have to remember this table. Is very important table. Okay, so coming to the pathogenesis of ascites, how is ascites formed? Usually what happens is, so the main reason for ascites is portal hypertension. Okay, so the portal hypertension directly leads to ascites. So what happens here is, I've already told you, in cirrhosis there is reduced albumin. Albumin synthesis is reduced because there is absolute no function of the liver. So whenever there is reduced albumin, you have decreased oncotic pressure. Oncotic pressure is reduced, that will lead to transudation of the fluid. So that will cause ascites. This is one common cause. Okay, then the other cause is you have splanchnic vasodilatation. This splanchnic vasodilatation is mainly seen due to portal hypertension. So whenever there is splanchnic vasodilatation, you have underfilling of circulation. So whenever there is vasodilatation, that lead to activation of renin-angiotensin system, obviously, because there is vasodilatation, and that will lead to increase in the synthesis of aldosterone. Whenever there is increased in aldosterone, what is the function of aldosterone? Absorption of sodium, secretion of potassium. So whenever this increase of aldosterone, there is always absorption of sodium, that will lead to salt and water retention, and this is the cause of ascites. This is one more cause of ascites. Okay, so just remember, in cirrhosis always the aldosterone metabolism is reduced, so it is a condition of hyperaldosteronism. It is a condition of hyperaldosteronism that will cause increased sodium and water retention. That's why you restrict sodium in patients with cirrhosis, and also water intake. So, and also give them diuretics, so to prevent this ascites. Okay, so this is very important. One of the causes portal hypertension, the other one is hyperaldosteronism due to splanchnic vasodilatation. This is the main reason for this activation of renin angiotensin and aldosterone. So this is what happens. See, whenever this is what happens. Okay, so whenever a patient with cirrhosis, the liver is not functioning here. Okay, So whatever the blood has to go from here to here. So it is usually because there is plastic vasodilatation, there is usually blockage here. The blood cannot go there, even if it goes, because the sinusoids are completely destroyed. So the flow is tampered. So because there is flow is not going to the liver, the blood flow will be like, there'll be a portal hypertension. So that will lead to formation of collaterals. So you see this, there'll be multiple collateral formations. Like you see this collateral circulation. So this is mainly due to increase in the nitric oxide. Okay, so nitric oxide, increase in nitric oxide is the reason for formation of this collateral circulation that will lead to dilatations, plastic vasodilatation, and also formation of angiogenesis. Okay, so whenever there is angiogenesis, there increased in the formation of collateral vessels. Okay, so usually esophageal varices, rectal varices, so there are multiple varices. So that is the reason for forming, because of this increased nitric oxide, usually collaterals are formed. Whenever collaterals are formed, you prevent it by giving beta blockers, okay, and also angiogenesis inhibitors. So that's why beta blockers are indicated, very much indicated to prevent this portal hypertension. Okay. So this is how splenic circulation, because of the increased nitric oxide is increased, and that's how you cause a dilatation. Okay, so this is the main reason for collateral formation. So coming to the portal hypertension, so how do you define portal hypertension? Portal hypertension, it is defined as elevation of hepatic venous pressure gradient greater than 5 mm of Hg. So what is this? See, usually what happens is portal hypertension, the pressure in the portal vein, you cannot measure it directly because it's not possible to go from the jugular vein into the portal vein. It's not possible, practically possible. That will cause usually infection. So what they'll do is, it is a hepatic venous pressure gradient. It's an indirect measure of the portal vein pressure. So how do you do it? You usually go from the inferior vena cava, and I'll show you a better picture for this. So what you do is, you go from the inferior vena cava. From the inferior vena cava, you go to the hepatic veins. From the hepatic veins, you first measure the free hepatic venous pressure. Okay, so in the hepatic vein, usually you measure the free hepatic venous pressure, and then you clamp it. You send a balloon there and you completely clamp the hepatic vein. Then you measure again, you measure the pressure. That's called hepatic venous wedge pressure. So first you measure hepatic venous free pressure, and then you clamp it with a balloon, and measure the hepatic venous wedge pressure. So this difference of the hepatic venous wedge pressure and the hepatic venous free pressure is known as the hepatic venous pressure gradient. Okay, so that's if this hepatic venous pressure gradient is greater than 5 mm of Hg, you label it as portal hypertension. Okay, so that's how you measure the define portal hypertension. So you have to measure the hepatic venous pressure gradient. So it mainly occurs due to two hemodynamic processes, this portal hypertension. One is due to increased intrahepatic resistance to the passage of blood through the liver due to cirrhosis and degenerative nodules, because absolutely cirrhosis, liver is completely irreversibly damaged, and that causes because the blood from the portal vein reaching the sinusoids is not able to go to the hepatic veins. So there is intrahepatic resistance, increase in the intrahepatic resistance to the passage of blood. And the second reason is increased splenic blood flow, secondary to vasodilatation within the splenic. So one other reason is splenic vasodilatation, I've already told. So because the liver is, the sinusoids are completely destroyed, so the blood blood flow into the liver cannot take place due to increased splenic vasodilatation. This will lead to formation of varices, multiple collateral formations. Okay. So you divide this portal hypertension into three types. The first one is pre-hepatic, okay. Then you have intrahepatic. Then you have post-hepatic, okay. So pre-hepatic is, see, you see this mark here. You see whatever the the obstruction is before this, okay. So you call it as pre-hepatic. That is before this hepatic. So one of the most common is usually seen in pregnancies, portal vein thrombosis. So here, anywhere here, portal vein, there is thrombosis in that due to sepsis, usually due to umbilical portal pyemia or any coagulation disorders. So that will cause portal vein thrombosis. Whenever there is thrombosis here, blood cannot go there. That will lead to splanchnic vasodilatation here, collateral formation and portal hypertension. Okay. Another cause is abdominal trauma, including surgeries, any major surgeries. So causing abdominal trauma that can cause portal vein thrombosis. So the next coming to intrahepatic. Okay. Intrahepatic, anywhere in the liver. Okay. Intrahepatic is divided into pre-sinusoidal, sinusoidal and post-sinusoidal. Okay. So pre-sinusoidal, the number two, you can hear this is pre-sinusoidal. Anywhere here, it's called pre-sinusoidal. Schistosomiasis is the most common condition in these pre-sinusoidal. So, and congenital hepatic fibrosis, some of the drugs, vinyl chloride, sarcoidosis. So these are the conditions causing pre-sinusoidal here. And coming to sinusoidal, so most common is cirrhosis. So completely, it causes regenerative nodules and there is fibrosis. So in cirrhosis, completely sinusoidal obstruction is seen. And also polycystic liver disease, nodular regenerative hyperplasia, any metastatic malignant disease like hepatocellular carcinoma. So this is sinusoidal, intrahepatic sinusoidal. Then coming to post sinusoidal. So this is number four. So this vein occlusive disease. So this is post sinusoidal. Then you have post hepatic, that is after this. This is the hepatic vein here. So after this, number five. Okay, this is anywhere, if the obstruction is anywhere here. So most common is Bucciari syndrome, that is hepatic vein thrombosis. Bucciari syndrome is nothing but hepatic vein thrombosis. So this is again more commonly seen in females, usually in the pregnancies again. So this is post hepatic, that is after the hepatic, just above this. So this is how you def just remember this diagram. That's it'll be very easy. So if the obstruction is below this portal vein, it is prehepatic. Then you have intrahepatic, pre-sinusoidal, sinusoidal, post-sinusoidal. Then you have post-hepatic. Okay, number five here, that is Bucciari syndrome. So portal hypertension, just remember this diagram. It's very easy to remember. So I've already told portal vein collateral. This is how it happens. Whenever there is splanchnic vasodilatation, they'll lead to angiogenesis due to increased nitric oxide. So that will cause a number of collaterals. So you have esophageal and gastric varices, okay, and short gastric veins. You have azygous veins, collateral formations, gastroepiploic veins, splenic veins, inferior. So you see angiogenesis everywhere, even in the hemorrhoids. So that's why you can mistaken the patient to be a case of hemorrhoids instead of portal hypertension. That's why it is very important to take a history of anything related to portal hypertension if the patient presents with lower GI bleed. So retroperitoneal, usually patient will have caput medicae, that is dilatation of the umbilical veins. So this is how the patient will present with portal vein collaterals will present with. So how do you treat ascites? So first thing you do is dietary restriction. So you restrict sodium, usually restrict to less than 2 grams per day, not more than 2 grams per day. And also you measure the weight daily. See, one more thing is you have to give diuretics. So most commonly given is spironolactone. Because why do you use spironolactone? I've already told, because in cirrhosis there is hyperaldosteronism. So whenever there is increased aldosterone, there will be increased sodium absorption as well as increased potassium excretion. So that will lead to hypokalemia. So you want to prevent that. So spironolactone is a potassium-sparing diuretic. So that's why spironolactone is the preferred drug of choice for a patient with cirrhosis. So usually you can the maximum dose of spironolactone is around 400 milligrams per day. So you measure the daily weight. So depending on that weight, you give diuretic dosage. Every day you measure, and depending on that, give diuretics. So there's a condition called refractory ascites. What is refractory ascites? If the ascites is not controlled by sodium restriction, that is, even if it's not controlled with less than 2 grams per day, and also giving maximum diuretic dose, that is spironolactone. This is 400. I'm sorry, here mistake. it is 400 milligrams per day, or furosemide 160 milligrams per day. So in spite of giving these maximum dose, and if it is not controlled by sodium restriction, you call this condition as refractory ascites, that is ascites not responding to your usual treatment. So what do you do then? If it is refractory ascites, you don't have any other go than going for large volume paracentesis. So large volume paracentesis will aggravate the hypoalbuminemia. Already there is albumin reduced. If you do large volume paracentesis, so that's why you'll have to replace with albumin. So you have to give and do dietary sodium restriction along with diuretics. High dose, you have to give maximum dose along with large volume paracentesis with albumin. So even if it is not controlled with that, so you consider tips. So I'll tell you what tips is. Then either consider tips or continue LVP with albumin as needed. And if it's not controlled, then liver transplantation is the only treatment of choice here. Okay. So what is tips? So it is nothing but transjugular intrahepatic portosystemic stent. So usually tips is not usually preferred. It is only done if you are planning the patient for liver transplantation, so you just want to prolong. It is a temporary procedure. So because there are many complications for tips, most common is portal vein infections. So infection is the most common cause. So that's why it is only done as a temporary procedure before if the patient is going for any liver transplantation. So what do you do is, so let's say the patient is having cirrhosis. Okay, so the blood from the portal vein goes to the sinuses, but from the sinusoids cannot reach the hepatic vein because the sinusoids are completely damaged. So what do you do here is, and that will lead to splanchic vasodilatation and collateral formations. So what you're doing is, so you'll place a stent from the portal vein directly to the hepatic vein and the inferior vena cava, so that it will bypass the liver and directly from the portal vein it goes to the hepatic vein, and so that the other organs are not affected. Okay, so this is what you call tips. So you'll just connect portal vein to the hepatic vein and from there to the inferior vena cava. So is nothing but a bypass procedure. It's something but a bypass. You connect portal vein to hepatic vein. So this is only a temporary procedure. If you are planning for any liver transplantation in the meantime, so just want to just to prevent a patient going bad, so dips is usually done. So what are the complications of portal hypertension? Usually variceal bleeding is the most important complication. The patient presents with upper GI bleed, so esophageal varices and gastric varices, and also you have congestive gastropathy and then hypersplenism. That's why, you know, patient with cirrhosis, they usually present with thrombocytopenias, because there is spleen is enlarged splenomegaly, that will lead to excess destruction of the blood cells. So then you have ascites, iron deficiency anemia, because the patients usually have massive GI bleeds, so that will lead to iron deficiency anemia, and also renal failure, because so you're giving high dose diuretics. So and also hepatorenal syndrome is one other complication that will cause renal failure, and then hepatic encephalopathy. So these are the complications. I'll talk about the complications in the next class. So I'll just continue with alcoholic liver disease. So the clinical entity of alcoholic liver disease, it has three categories. The first and most common is fatty liver. See, it's almost seen in 80 to 90% of any patient who's on alcohol abuse. So fatty liver is the initial stage, you can call it as. So it is asymptomatic abnormal liver biochemistry. Usually the enzymes and bilirubins are completely normal here. Only GGT is the only enzyme which may be a little bit raised. And the liver is usually normal, or it could be mild hepatomegaly may be seen. So here usually some of the symptoms like nausea, vomiting, and abdominal pain may be seen, but it's very rare to have any symptoms. Usually it is asymptomatic. Okay, it's the initial stage. Fatty liver, the patient is usually normal, and it is usually an irreversible condition. The patient usually get back to normal once he stops taking alcohol. Then alcoholic hepatitis is a bit dangerous condition. Usually the patients here, because there is hepatitis, usually patients has jaundice, hyperbilirubins, and the patient will be malnourished, and the patient will have hepatomegaly, pain, abdomen and hepatomegaly, and features of portal hypertension are usually seen, like ascites and encephalopathy. and then coming to cirrhosis. It's an irreversible condition wherein stigmata of all the chronic liver disease symptoms are seen. Patients will have ascites, variceal bleeding, encephalopathy. Usually the size of the liver is shrunken, contracted, because there is formation of the nodules, micro nodules, that will cause shrinkage of the liver. So usually it is small and shrunken. If it is in the early part of early stage of liver, that's when liver could be a little bit hepatomegaly could be seen. If it's in the early stage, usually it is shrunken. And then coming to the hepatocellular carcinomas. So what is the amount of alcohol in each beer? Usually it has 3.5 to 9%. Wine has around 10 to 12%, and vodka, rum, gin, all this has 37.5%, and whiskey and brandy has 40%. So that's why, you know, it depends what is taking. So if it's whiskey or brandy, usually you call it the amount of alcohol causing. Usually it is around 120 to 180 milligrams per day, and that's for around 12 to 16 years, can cause cirrhosis in males, and that's exactly half the amount in the case of females. Okay, so just remember the percentage alcohol. They may ask you in some vivas and all. So usually in men, 40 to 80 grams per day of alcohol produces fatty liver, okay, and 160 grams per day for 10 to 20 years can cause either cirrhosis or hepatitis. Okay, so and women, it's exactly half of this. So if it's only 80 grams for 10 to 20 years can cause cirrhosis in females, whereas it's 160. So females are usually more susceptible, and only just half the dose is enough for them to cause cirrhosis. And hepatitis C infection concurrent with alcoholic liver disease is associated with younger stage for severity. So any patient with hepatitis C, if he has alcohol abuse, he is more prone for, he is almost double more, has higher risk for forming cirrhosis of liver. So again, genetics, you have this gene called PNPLA3, palatine-like phospholipase domain containing protein 3. It has been associated with cirrhosis. So this is one genetic conditions. And fatty liver, alcohol injury does not require malnutrition, but obesity and non-alcoholic fatty livers are also the risk factors. So that's why patients should receive continuous nutrition support. So make sure that patients are not obese, and that will cause non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So so what are the pathogenesis of alcoholic liver? Alcohol is the main reason. Alcohol causes, there is an enzyme called alcohol dehydrogenase. So this alcohol dehydrogenase converts alcohol into acetaldehyde, and acetaldehyde is again converted into acetate in the presence of enzyme known as acetaldehyde dehydrogenase. Okay, so alcohol dehydrogenase is a major enzyme contributing to the metabolism of alcohol in the liver. Okay, so this acetaldehyde is the major reason for causing all the toxic effects. Acetaldehyde. So acetaldehyde, it combines with all the proteins to form acetaldehyde adducts, so which can cause increase in the oxidative stress, and also it will disturb the immune system, and it also activate the Kupffer cells. Okay, so it can, alcohol can also it is also permeable to gut, and it will cause to increase in endotoxins that will activate the Kupffer cells. Kupffer cells are known as macrophages of the liver. Okay, so mainly plays a role in immunity. So Kupffer cells will cause increase in the cytokines, all these tumor necrosis factor alpha, interleukin 6. So that will lead to formation, that will lead to inflammation, increased inflammatory mediators. So that will damage the liver. So this is the main reason. So acetaldehyde is the major component which is responsible for all this. Then also the glutathione is reduced here. So other factors like viral hepatitis, the patient has hepatitis C, is more prone for alcohol liver disease, and also hemochromatosis. So hemochromatosis is nothing but iron deposition in the liver. So the patients will have more prone for this, and also genetic susceptibility. I've already told this is a PNPLA3 gene, they are more prone. Okay, So just remember, this acetaldehyde is the major factor for causing all the toxic effects of the alcohol. So it'll alcohol actually can reach the gut and increase in the lipopolysaccharides, and that will cause increase in the toll receptor factor 4 activation, that will lead to increase in the TNF factors. So that's why you'll give the treatment of choice is TNF alpha inhibitors. So then that will cause hepatic inflammation and injury, that will cause increased systemic inflammation, and that lead to encephalopathy, brain injury, and also lung injury. So this is how alcohol is responsible for all these diseases. So a fatty liver, I've already told, accumulation of fat within the hepatocytes. So it is initial and the most common histological response to alcoholic ingestion. Around 80 to 90% of the patients will have fatty liver, and it is reversible and is also being benign condition. So it's usually reversible on abstinence of alcohol. Coming to alcoholic hepatitis, it is an hepatocyte injury caused characterized by ballooning, degeneration, spotty necrosis, and also increase in the polymorphonuclear infiltrate and fibrosis. So all these are seen in alcoholic hepatitis. There is fibrosis, there can be increase in the polymorphonuclear infiltrate, neutrophils, and also ballooning degeneration, and also spotty necrosis. So all these conditions, this is how you define alcoholic hepatitis. So it is precursor to the development of cirrhosis, second stage you call it as. So it is a precursor to development of cirrhosis. It is also like a fatty liver, it is also reversible with cessation of drinking, but is more dangerous than fatty liver. So already patient develops jaundice, and there is good amount of damage to the liver, but it is reversible with immediate stoppage of alcohol. So clinical features, usually patients present with jaundice, nausea, vomiting. The patient usually complains of right upper quadrant discomfort, and then patient may have a fever, then Spider-Newy, and then portal hypertension, like a situs, upper GI bleed. So all these can be seen in alcoholic hepatitis. So lab diagnosis. So first thing you do is liver function test. So SGOT, it is increased, but just remember it is never greater than 400 international units per liter. So whereas in viral hepatitis, usually it is in thousands. So how do you differentiate viral hepatitis with alcoholic hepatitis? Usually the enzymes are less than 400, okay? So SGPT is also increased, but is less than 400. But always remember, SGOT by SGPT ratio is always greater than 1. So why is it greater than 1? Because SGPT is little bit less than SGOT. This shows that SGPT is less than SGOT. That is because in alcohol patients, there is a deficiency of an enzyme known as pyridoxal phosphate. So pyridoxal phosphate is required for synthesis of SGPT, that is ALT. So that's why, so this ratio is always SGOT is greater than SGPT. Okay, so because pyridoxal phosphate is reduced in alcohol patients, that's why ALT is always lesser than AST. So this ratio is always greater than, this table is very important. SGOT by SGPT, AST is also known as SGOT. So SGOT by SGPT is usually greater than 1. Then you have GGTP, it is usually not specific to alcohol, but GGT is increased. So any form of fatty liver, usually GGT is increased. Then bilirubins, usually bilirubin is only raised in alcoholic hepatitis, but not in fatty livers. Okay, so usually marked increase in alcoholic hepatitis, and also alkaline phosphate usually is normal. So alcoholic hepatitis, usually patients may present with hepatic encephalopathy. So what you do is, first thing you do, any patient with alcoholic, you suspecting alcoholic hepatitis, bilirubin is raised and is having typical history of alcohol intake, you calculate a score known as Madry's discrimination factor, DF factor. So how do you calculate DF factor? It has a formula known as 4.6 into prothrombin time plus serum bilirubin, total bilirubin. So prothrombin time, usually you calculate control minus the actual value, the actual value minus control plus total bilirubin. That is 4.6 into corrected prothrombin time plus total bilirubin. Let's say the prothrombin time is around 30, okay? So, and total bilirubin is around 10. So 30 minus control is usually around 10. So 30 minus 10 is 20. 20 plus total bilirubin is 10. So 30 into 4.6. So that will be greater than 32, more greater than 32. So whenever the patient has discrimination factor greater than 32, it's an indication for starting patient on steroids, because to reduce the inflammation. So if the patient doesn't have any active GI bleed, usually you start with steroid for 40 milligrams for 7 days. So if serum bilirubin's level decrease, you continue 40 milligrams for another 21 days, that is total of one month. So if the patient has active GI bleed or any renal failure, hepatorenal syndrome, or patient has SBP, spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, usually you don't give steroids because that will aggravate. So in that those conditions, pentoxifilin is given. Pentoxifilin is nothing but TNF-alpha inhibitor. So oral pentoxifilin 400 milligrams 3 times daily, so we give it for 28 days. So whenever DF factor is greater than 32, so that's an indication for starting either prednisolone or pentoxifilin. So, and also there's a score known as MELD score, okay? So model for end stage liver disease, MELD score. So you calculate, there are MELD score calculators, specific formula. This is not very important for you. So just remember the MELD score is less than 9. So usually the complications are usually not seen, no complications in 97%. And 1 year survival is little bit more. If the MELD score is 10 to 19, no complications in 90%. And if the MELD score is 30 to 39, usually the complications are in 50%. Okay. So cirrhosis, it is always, cirrhosis is defined histopathologically. So to define cirrhosis, you should have a biopsy to call it as cirrhosis. Usually you cannot diagnose cirrhosis usually on clinically or radiologically. So it is nothing but development of fibrosis to the point that there is architectural distortion with the formation of regenerative nodules. So there is development of fibrosis, and the second one, there is formation of regenerative nodules. All this is usually seen on biopsy, and it is always irreversible. Fatty liver and alcohol hepatitis are reversible, but cirrhosis is always irreversible. So what are the causes of cirrhosis? You have viral hepatitis. Usually hepatitis B and C are the most common cause. Hepatitis D is also common, but it's very rare. Then you have autoimmune hepatitis. Then you have primary biliary cirrhosis, primary sclerosing cholangitis, alcohol abuse, arsenic abuse, alpha-1, some of the metabolic conditions like alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiencies, glycogen storage disorders, hemochromatosis, Wilson's disease, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. This is very common in European countries, in the Western countries. So then biliary atresias, any stones, cholelithiasis, tumors, and then Bucherry syndrome, cardiofibrosis. So some of the genetic conditions like cystic fibrosis, any biliary injuries, like when you do ERCP, that can cause biliary injuries. Then drugs, vitamin A, high dose of vitamin E, and methotrexate. So these are the some common conditions of cirrhosis. So see, this is how you see a patient with of biopsy of patient with say liver scene. So this is completely normal. It has portal tract, portal triad, central veins. So everything is intact here. Whereas in fatty liver, there is increase in accumulation of fat in the hepatocytes. So fat lobules are usually seen in fatty liver. Otherwise, the other there is no fibrosis usually seen in fatty liver. There is fibrosis seen in late part of fatty liver and also in alcoholic hepatitis. So in alcoholic hepatitis, in addition to fibrosis, it is you also see neutrophils. I've already told in the hepatic hepatitis definition, there is fibrosis, there is also formation of polymorphonuclear infiltrates. So all these, all the neutrophils. Then you have nodules formations. So all these are seen in hepatitis. Then you have micronodular cirrhosis, alcohol conditions. This is how completely it is replaced by fibrosis and then nodular formation. Nodular formation usually not seen in alcoholic hepatitis, only seen in micronodular cirrhosis. So macronodular cirrhosis usually seen in hepatocellular carcinoma and also Wilson's disease. So the micronodular is usually seen in alcohol liver disease and others like hemochromatosis. All these are micro. Macro are Wilson's hepatocellular carcinoma. Okay, so this is our picture of biopsy of alcohol liver disease. So pathogenesis in cirrhosis, usually the major cell responsible, because stellate cell, I've already told, it is the stellate cell is the reason for formation of collagen. Okay, collagen forming cells. So if, due to the alcohol abuse, you have Kupffer cell activation. Kupffer cells in turn activate hepatic stellate cells. So hepatic stellate cell activation will lead to formation of myofibroblast, that will lead to formation of fibrosis. Okay, so this is how fibrosis is formed, fibrogenesis. Okay, so usually in cirrhosis there is deposition of collagen in the space of disc A. This is normal and this is patient with cirrhosis. So you see hepatocytes are destroyed and stellate cells are activated. See, this is hepatic stellate cells normal. You see activation of the hepatic stellate cells. You see deposition of collagen in the space of disc A. There is no collagen here. And the fenestrae are completely gone. There is no space here. So sinusoidal endothelial cell, there is constriction of the sinusoids. So the fluids and all the nutrients cannot pass through. So this is our patient with cirrhosis. Okay. So this is how a patient with normal liver has. So normal liver, it has portal tract. What is portal tract? I've already told. Portal tract has, portal tract or trier has a portal vein. It has a bile duct, hepatic artery, and the hepatic vein. Okay, and also this forms the portal triad. Okay, so. See, what happens is in the portal tract, all the hepatocytes are again connected to the central veins. So all this is intact, the portal vein and all intact in the case of normal. Normally it is seen. I already discussed the bile flow is always from the portal tract to the central vein, whereas the blood flow is exactly opposite. Okay, from the central vein to the portal tract. So bridging, this is how bridging fibrosis looks like. See, this is a case of alcoholic hepatitis. So you see fibrosis, this red color thing is a fibrosis, bridging fibrosis, and then you have all the fat deposition. All these are the fat deposition in the hepatocytes. This is our patient with bridging fibrosis is seen. And then you have nodules. So these are the nodules. So here completely the portal tract architecture is distorted completely. And then completely it forms these orange things are the fibrotic patches, and then you have cirrhotic nodules. This is a picture of cirrhosis of liver. So this is how a patient on imaging looks like. So the liver is shrunken, spleen is enlarged here. This is the spleen. So you see spleen is enlarged, and also you have collateral vessels here. These are the collateral vessels around the proximal stomach. And then you have irregular outline, and the liver is normal. Liver is shrunken here. Okay, it is small and has irregular outline. You see this irregular. So this liver and spleen is enlarged. Usually, and one more thing, clinically, the most important clinical diagnosis for portal hypertension is splenomegaly. So if you have any clinical case of ascites, so they ask you, how do you say the patient has portal hypertension? It's clinically you look for spleen. The spleen is enlarged, usually the patient has portal hypertension. So clinical features of hepatic cirrhosis, usually patients has, if the patient is in the initial stage, hepatomegaly is seen. If it's in the late stage, usually liver size is reduced. Then patient has jaundice, ascites, and circulatory changes like spinal telangiectasia, palmar arrhythmia, endocrine changes like loss of libido, because usually the patients the testosterone hormone is converted to estrogens. So hyperestrogen is responsible for all these causes, loss of libido, hair loss, and men you have gynecomastia, painful condition, and testicular atrophy, impotence. Women you have breast atrophy, irregular menses, amenorrhea. Hemorrhagic tendencies, because patient has thrombocytopenia, they'll have bruises per epistaxis. Portal hypertension is seen. Patients has splenomegaly, collateral vessel formation, variceal bleeding. Then patient may have hepatic encephalopathy with other features like pigmentation, distal clubbing, Dupuytren's contracture. So all these are very important. So clinical features of cirrhosis, all these can be seen. So management, you have to restrict alcohol, complete abstinence of alcohol. So diuretics, you have to tell them this is very important. The first and major thing you should do is abstinence of alcohol. Then diuretics, you give spironolactone, so you can give up to 400 milligrams per day. Beta blockers, I've already told. So in order to prevent the angiogenesis and collaterals and portal hypertension, to prevent upper GI bleed, you give beta blockers, usually propranolol, give up to 40 milligrams per day. So it is only prophylactic. It is not the it's not that you it completely stops GI bleed. It is only prophylactic measure to prevent in the future. Okay. Then glucocorticoids and TNF alpha inhibitors. The patient has alcoholic hepatitis, so you may have to start with glucocorticoids or TNF alpha inhibitors. And also nutrition is very important, because the patient has hypoalbumin, decrease in the albumin. So that's why protein nutrition is very important. You give around 2500 calories per day is must for that patient, and you'll have to recommend to take high protein diet. And vitamin supplements, so vitamins, there are many vitamins which are reduced because it's a chronic conditions and immunocompromised status. Yeah, they are prone for many infections, so that's why high vitamin C's, so vitamin D, so all these are usually recommends. So vitamin supplements are very important in cirrhosis patients. So ultimately liver transplantation is the treatment of choice. So so all these are just to temporary and to prolong the life of the patient, but the only treatment for that is liver transplantation. Okay, so there is some scoring. Chalpuck classification is very important to know the prognosis of cirrhosis. So you have these five categories: encephalopathy, bilirubins, serum albumin, prothrombin time, and ascites. Okay. So you have scores of 1, 2, 3. If there is no encephalopathy, usually it is none. If it is mild 2, marked 3. Okay. So you just have to remember, they may tell you, they may ask a question like that. Like a patient with bilirubin around 7.8. Patients has serum albumin around 2.5. And patient has ascites and prothrombin time around 4. So what is the Chalpuck score is? Calculate the Chalpuck score. Okay, so that's how the question can come. So you calculate the score at the end. Then usually if it is less than 7, you call it as Chalpuck score class A. If it is 7 to 9, it is B. It is greater than 9, it is C. So A and B are usually labeled as decompensated cirrhosis. If the patient has a score of greater than 9, it is if the score is either less than 7 or 7 to 9, so it is compensated. If it is greater than 9, it is usually decompensated. Prognosis is very poor. So just remember Chalpuck, just remember what are the factors they see in Chalpuck score: encephalopathy, bilirubins, albumin, prothrombin time, and ascites. So usually the survival, if the Chalpuck score is around A, 1 year survival is only 82, 10 year survival is 25%, only 25%. And if it is C, 10 year survival is almost 0%, and B, it is only 7 years. Okay. So that's why it will tell you the prognosis in case of cirrhosis of liver. Okay. All right. So just make sure that you go through the topics. Whatever I am telling you, just go through Davidson. Just go through Davidson. So if you have time, you can also go through Harrison's. So I usually take my slides usually from these three books. So make sure you read the same day so that you remember and you don't forget it. Okay. All right. Thank you.